Love me tender, love me sweet, never let me go. You have made my life complete, and I love you so. Love me tender, love me true, all my dreams fulfill. For my darling, I love you, and I always will. Love me tender, love me long, take me to your heart. For it's there that I belong, and will never part. Love me tender, love me true, all my dreams fulfill. For my darling, I love you, and I always will. Love me tender, love me dear, tell me you are mine. I'll be yours through all the years, till the end of time. Love me tender, love me true, all my dreams fulfill. For my darling, I love you, and I always will. Wise men say only fools run, but I can't help falling in love with you. Shall I stay? Would it be a sin if I can't help falling in love with you? Like a river flows surely to the sea, darling, so it goes. Some things are meant to be. Falling in love.
in the meadow.
Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet they shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died and I behold, I am alive forevermore. Because I live, you shall also live also. Please be seated. Welcome to Vermont Community Church. I'm lay pastor Michelle Massaro. We have gathered this morning in God's presence as family and friends to remember Donna and to commend her soul into the gracious care of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We come together in grief, acknowledging our human loss. May God grant us grace that in pain we may find comfort and sorrow hope and death resurrection. Dying, Christ destroyed our death. Rising, Christ restored our life. Here and now, we are God's children. What we shall be has not yet been revealed. But we know that when Christ appears, we will be like him. For we shall see Christ as he is. This is our Christian hope. Please join me in prayer. Eternal God, we praise you for this great company of all those who have finished their course in faith and now rest from their labor. We praise you for all those dear to us, whom we name silently in our hearts before you. Especially, we praise you for Donna, whom you have graciously received into your presence. To all of these, grant your peace. Let perpetual light shine upon them. And help us so to believe where we have not seen, that your presence may lead us through our years and bring us at last
with them into joy of your home, not made with hands, but eternal in the heavens. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. At this time, I'd like to introduce Pastor Penny Plott for great news to Donna.
Hear the words from Paul from Romans chapter 8. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels or rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. And he wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, but someone may ask, how are the dead raised? With what kind of body will they come? There are also heavenly bodies and there are earthly bodies. But the splendor of the heavenly bodies is one kind, and the splendor of the earthly bodies is another. I declare to you that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a flash, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised, and we will be changed. O death, where is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And from the Gospel of John, chapter 14, Jesus said to his disciples, do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If that were not so, I would have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me so that you may also be where I am. You know the way and the place that I'm going. But Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way? And Jesus answered him. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really knew me, you will know my Father as well. And from now on, you do know him, and you have seen him. If you would bow your heads with me. Oh Lord, we come today with our hearts heavy, filling the loss of Donna's presence. Fill us with your hope and the power of your resurrection. We ask that your Holy Spirit would attend to our souls and comfort us as we look to you for assurance and peace. We can take comfort in you as a true friend and place our burdens and cares at your feet. And knowing that we would face times of grief and a loss for words, you even gave us your prayer that we could pray to you anytime and in any place. At this time, if you would join with me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, I have found that each person has their very own Bible verse or passage. That reflects their life, whether they even recognize it or not. I like to look at that person's life as a completed puzzle made up of so many different pieces, all unique and individual, and yet they fit together perfectly to make the beautiful finished picture. That picture starts out like a blank canvas, and as each colorful memory splashes on the awaiting surface, it starts to form a true depiction of that individual, the masterpiece that God had created them to become. And I have been doing this for 17 years, and no two people have had the same verse. And Donna's no exception. Her verse is from 1 Peter 3, verse 4. It says, but let it be the hidden person of the heart with the imperishable quality of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is precious in the sight of God. This is Donna's obituary. Donna May Smith, at age 82 of Fairmont, Nebraska, passed away surrounded by family in Lincoln, Nebraska on Friday, March 8, 2024. She was born to Fred and Monty Burnett Clock in York, Nebraska on April 14, 1941. Donna loved the farm and enjoyed country living. The family farmstead has been in her family since 1888. She attended country school and later McCool Junction School, where she graduated in 1958. As a young girl, she would ride and show horses with her parents at the horse shows and parades. In 1961, she fell in love and eloped and married Dwayne E. Smith of Fairmont, Nebraska on June 5, 1961 in Belleville, Kansas. After they were married, they lived in Lincoln for a short time, where Dwayne worked. And during this time, her talents to become an accomplished organist would come to play. She would get the opportunity to fill in as organist on the Lita Powell Drake show, morning show on Channel 10 and 11 in the 60s. Donna returned to the farm after passing of her father in 1966. Dwayne and Donna resumed farming on the family homestead she had called home. She became a devoted housewife, mother, and one of the hardest working farm wives out there. After moving back, she became a member of the Happy Hour Club that her mom had also belonged to. One of her true loves was dolls, and this stemmed from her childhood to the present time. She adored anything doll-related, buggies, clothing, and toys. She would eventually make it her part-time business of traveling afar to sell and show her favorite Jan Hogarth Victorian dolls and figurines at doll shows. A long family tradition was enjoying and spending time relaxing at the Harlan County Lake Cabin, the joy of fishing until wee early morning hours, sometimes catching hundreds of fish, was one of her favorite pastimes. Later in life, after retiring from farming, she took a job at Grand Central Deli, where she enjoyed serving customers and making friends. She enjoyed the time she spent with family and friends. There were many fun times, adventures, and lots of late-night card games with special friends, Dick and Deanna Arbuck. She was preceded in death by her parents, Fred and Monty Clock, brother Leslie Clock, father and mother-in-law Lloyd Bell and Blanche Smith, sister-in-law Marion Toon, and brother-in-law Dick Smith and Jerry Smith. Those left to cherish her memory are her husband of 62 years, Dwayne, daughter Tammy Siskel, and her husband Jeremy, daughter Danelle King Smith and wife Heather, and her son Jacob Guru. Also surviving her long-flung friend, Deanna Arbuck, Luna, her beloved Pomeranian, and she will be fondly remembered, dearly loved, greatly missed, and everyone who had the privilege of knowing her. Well, it was Donna that had quite the full years of growing up on the farm. There was a big difference between her and her brother Les, 15 years to be exact. So they each got to see Grandma and Grandma a little differently than Mom and Dad. And it was when Donna was in high school that she and Mary Quick Lindquist were hanging out together, and they came across Dwayne Smith and a buddy who asked if they wanted to go on an adventure. I won't even tell you what the adventure was, but anyway, they said, sure. And that was the start of a lifelong friendship and more. Donna's family did not have a telephone, so Dwayne had to drive out to see her. The first time he drove in, Monty came walking out to the end of the driveway to meet him. She wanted to know who was calling on her daughter. He took Donna out to ice cream in McCool Junction for their very first real date. From there, they mailed letters back and forth, staying in touch, planning their next adventure. When the time came, the marriage was the talk. Donna decided to stay with family tradition and elope to Belleville, Kansas, just like her grandparents and her parents and her brother had. In fact, it wasn't until my folks got married that that was the first church wedding. So in good fashion, she left a note rolled up in her bed, and they snuck off. When the folks unrolled her bed at night is when they found the note that she and Dwayne had eloped. From there, they traveled to Yellowstone and back to Mount Rushmore on their honeymoon. When they came back home, Milo Peterson was with Monty, and at their entrance, she had tears in her eyes. Dwayne still wonders if it was tears of joy or... Don and Dwayne lived in Lincoln, and Dwayne signed up for the Army. They sent him to Oklahoma, and it was there that he decided to build a boat, and he named it the Don May. It was quite the story, actually. When he started to build it, he said, how are we going to get it out of here? It won't fit through the door. They kept telling him, don't worry, we'll get it figured out. out of the shed. I cut a hole big enough in the side of the shed to get the boat out and put up an overhead door. He said it was quite the beauty, and he took it out on the water and it floated just like it was supposed to. When Fred passed, they made the decision to come back home to the farmstead and help with the farming. Donna rolled up her sleeves and dug in, driving tractors, disking, plowing, planting, and driving in hydrous tanks. She did it all but the combine. And to help out, she taught Tammy how to cook. So that was one thing off of her duty list for the night. Tammy said she learned how to cook about every box of hamburger helper they make. One time Donna was out disking and it was doing what Nebraska winds do, blowing up a storm. She didn't have the cap. And when Dwayne saw her, it was a funny sight. He said she was just black with dirt except for the little round spots around her eyes from her glasses. Donna loved to go to the flea markets and the junk jaunts. She loved playing cards with friends until, as we said, the early, early morning hours. And fishing was one of her favorite pastimes, mostly anything that involved spending time with her best friend, Deanna Arnold. That made it best. Those two even went ice fishing on many occasions. In fact, Dwayne even made them a hut after sitting out on a bucket in the cold many times before. She loved the stained glass masterpieces that Dwayne made and always had an idea for a new one that he created. She liked collecting glassware, and her biggest passion was dolls. She started Donna's Country Collectibles. Donna possessed so many wonderfully endearing talents. She was never a gossip or found fault in anyone. And the same comment was repeated. She was a true image of a lady. I remember that she and Dwayne started videoing at school at McCool. It started way back when we had a basketball team that actually went to state. And he recorded all the memories, and from there on, he started recording everything, from spring concerts, Christmas concerts, to even some of the stuff I was in. And I don't think it stopped all the way through to know. She loved to travel. She loved merry-go-rounds. And in fact, she even got to go to the Merry-go-Round Museum. They traveled to Colorado, a train trip to Washington, and went to Connecticut. So much fun in 38 hours on a train. The fun stories of trying to eat and pour coffee on a moving train. I have to ask Dwayne about that. Donna hated flying, and yet she flew to Las Vegas, Washington State, Washington, D.C., and California. Her favorite loves were Harlan County Lake, and the best part, going to Republican City to Frida's Cafe, Blue Stem Lake, shopping in Omaha, and eating at the seafood buffet. And maybe a little bit of gambling. She loved her family, talking to Jeremy every day. She just loved it when people called. When Danelle turned 30, Heather had planned out that Don and Dwayne would meet her in the lobby of the hotel in Las Vegas to surprise her, which meant Donna had to get on a plane. And a surprise it was. Danelle came down to the lobby thinking that something was wrong with her credit card, and who should be sitting in the lobby at a slot machine but Donna. What people probably did not know is that she loved hot air balloons, and she loved going to the festival, got to attend in 2007. She loved Heather's son, Jacob, and the picture that he colored her is still on the fridge at the cabin. Donna loved people. She loved family. She loved friends. She had a very quiet, sweet spirit about her. And that is why Donna's verse is from 1 Peter 3:4. But let it be the hidden person of the heart with the imperishable quality of a gentle, quiet spirit, which is precious in the sight of God. She tried to live and leave an example to follow. We know that the ultimate legacy one can leave is a faith in God and in His Son, Jesus Christ. It is during these times of grief and sadness that we can find ourselves searching and seeking. It is during the times of brokenheartedness that we can become receptive to the tugging on our hearts from Christ. We have those quiet moments to feel His presence, His comfort and hope. Jesus said, "In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, for for I have overcome the world. Jesus became the ultimate atonement for our sins, making a way through that sin of the world and back to the Father. One of Jesus' enduring attributes was his quiet, sweet spirit, one that he called us to emulate, and that is what Donna did.
When I get where I'm going, on the far side of the sky, the first thing that I'm gonna do is spread my wings and fly. I'm gonna land beside a lion and run my fingers through his mane, or I might find out what it's like to ride a drop of rain. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. I will shed the sins and struggles I have carried all these years, and I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fear. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, don't cry for me down here. I'm gonna walk with my granddaddy, and he'll match me step for step. And I'll tell him how I've missed him every minute since he left. And then I'll hug his neck. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. I will shed the sins and struggles I have carried all these years, and I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fear. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, don't cry for me down here. So much pain and so much darkness in this world we stumble through. All these questions I can't answer, so much work to do. But when I get where I'm going, and I see my Maker's face, I'll stand forever in the light of His amazing grace. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, oh, when I get where I'm going, there'll be
skirt and pink outfit with pearls, and this was totally my mother. She loved the color pink, and that kind of stems from her mother. Her mother had a pink car, a pink house. She loved the color pink. So, of course, it kind of rubbed up on me. And that's after she passed, me and my sister went through her closet. And we opened up her closet. And I just took a wipe, and it didn't even shock me at all. But as we looked in her closet, I did not find one stitch of black. There was not a black shirt. There was not no black pants. There was no black coat. Zero. Nothing. This woman knew nothing in black. Everything, if you would open up her closet, looked like a rainbow. A rainbow of light, pastel colors, shiny. When you open up her closet, florals. And so she deeply had a passion for pink, and that's the reason why I chose to be the light of the room, because my mother loved the color pink. Also, I also wanted to point out that when my mom passed on March 8th, she was also born, when she was born April 14th, 1941, she was born in a snowstorm. Not too many people knew that. My mom always made an ongoing joke with me. She'd always say, "Tammy, you really can't count winter out until April 14th. And I said, "Okay, Mom." And that worked for many years. But then, it snowed May 1st on one year because it was me and Jeremy's anniversary. So again, she would always say, April 14th. I said, "Mom, we need to avoid April 14th because May 1st now is the ongoing date of snow." It was late, but that was always the place that she'd always seen snow. It was on her birthday because she was born in a snowstorm. Well, on the night that she had passed, in the early wee hour mornings as we departed the hospital, it began to snow. And I only thought, this was definitely my mom's doing, because she was born in a snowstorm, and she was going to leave in a snowstorm. And I think the snowstorm, when she passed away on March 8th, kind of took everybody by surprise when they woke up that morning. A lot of people had 4 or 5 inches of snow on the ground. Well, you can probably thank my mom for that, because she thought that would probably be the most fitting way to go out, since she came in that way. So, I guess we'll have to say May 1st, but she always giggled and said April 14th. If it would get to April 14th, we'd be okay. She also had a lot of people don't know, that she loved peacocks. She even coerced my dad into, when they lived at the farm, "Can you please buy me some peacocks?" So he bought her 2 peacocks. And I was a very young child. I was only probably 5 or 6 at the time. Danelle does not remember this, but the peacocks would just run around the farm. They had a shed to go to. People would come all over, and they would buy feathers from her peacocks. Because I'm like, "Wow, Donna Smith has peacocks. We need to go, I want some of those feathers." So they would always come over at the house, and she would sell the feathers. So as a young child, I was always to gather the feathers. If I see them, I need to pick them up and put them in the vase for her. She also, and most of you all know, she had a super big passion for dolls. And that's pretty evident. If you were to walk in the house today, you're surrounded by children everywhere. Doll faces everywhere, doll buggies, anything doll related. It's almost like stepping back in a Victorian time frame, because that's what she liked. And I think maybe that's why she liked the frills of the pink and the frills of the lace and the pearls. All stems back again from the Victorian, like Deanna Arbuckle would say, she's very much was a lady. She also had personalized license plates when she would go to these doll shows that said dolls on the back. So it was pretty obvious that this woman, when you look at people's license plates, "Oh, dolls." Yep, she had a passion for dolls. She also loved Pomeranians. She loved, even as when I was born, we had a Pomeranian, and I think its name was Tina Marie. And Tina Marie would always dump over the waste basket. So over the years, we had many. She had different Pomeranians. This last Pomeranian that she has, We call her Luna, but technically it's called Luna the Lunatic. She's crazy. We even had to go buy a trash can just so she couldn't tip it over. It was just like the first original Pom. But she loved her Poms. Pom anything. Oh, if it looks like a Pom, oh, gotta have it. Love it, love it, love it. So besides all the dolls in the house, we have little dog figurines too. And they're mostly all Pomeranians. A famous quote that she always had, and I always thought this was always kind of funny, and I think some of you would giggle who really knew her. If you would tell her something or say something like, well, it's going to be this much money, or it's this much. Did you know they spent this much? And she'd always reply, that's too much. Well, I found that quote to come from the Price is Right show, which she absolutely loved. She watched The Price is Right, and she loved the segment of that's too much. So anytime we'd always discuss anything, I say, well, you know, your grocery bill was $85. That's too much. You know, but with the price of everything going up, so that was one of her favorite little quotes, was that's too much. So anytime we were in society thinking through this funeral, we'd always giggle to ourselves, oh, if Mom was here and she'd hear how much I was, she'd say, oh, that's too much. So that's always in the back of my head. In the latter part of the years, Mom was not able to drive, so I drove her everywhere. I drove her to doctor's appointments, which we get usually once a week, I swear, if it wasn't for the eyes or the kidneys or the heart. I mean, I had a full itinerary on my calendar of where we were going to go that week. But every Wednesday was a given. We called it hair-tossing Wednesdays. On Wednesdays, she would go and we'd get her hair washed and get it all fixed up. And that's, she always called me Tuesday night with the grocery list and we plugged it into the Walmart app. So all I didn't have to run around Walmart. All we had to do was just pull up, say we're at number 10, and then throw everything in the back seat. And she just thought that was great. She's like, are you sure you don't have to tip these people? I'm like, no, Mom, you don't have to tip them. They're Walmart. This is part of the job. So she could never get, she thought that was just the coolest thing ever. Yeah, so hair tossing Wednesdays was a delight, but the biggest delight of all, we also had a co-captain on Wednesdays. There was a co-captain in the vehicle on Wednesdays, and her name was Miss Charlize. She is my 16-year-old schnauzer, and she loved my schnauzer, because my schnauzer, unlike the Pomeranian, the lunatic, my schnauzer was a very docile dog. Very much like she just listened to everything my mom had to say. She was like, you're the best doggy ever. And she was. She would just take it all in. And she, my mom put her arm around her. So on Wednesday, she always sat on the console of the truck. We always called her the co-pilot. And when we would go through a drive-thru, we always went through Runza because we had to get Dad some hamburgers. Her big thing was, make sure to order those ice cream cones. Make sure you order those two twist ice cream cones. Oh, yes, and we also need a puff cup. We can't forget the puff cup from Miss Shirley's. And she'd always say, every Wednesday when we're at this drive-thru, like I didn't know, but she always pointed out and said, this is the highlight of my week, coming here and getting ice cream. She loved ice cream. And it was funny because every time we went on Wednesdays, my friends, Kelly and Mike, would be working, and they knew right away when I came to the drive-thru, they knew who this was. They'd say, oh, hi, Tammy, how are you? We'd all start laughing, me and Mom. And then I would sometimes forget another passion she had. She loved honey mustard. So we always had to order honey mustard, and it was a couple times I forgot to order it. And we get to the drive-thru, they give us our ice cream cones. They always make sure they gave Mom the biggest ice cream cone. Because they'd always say, this one's for Mom. And it was always the biggest one. And then Charlize would be patiently waiting for her. But then Mike would say, well, you know what? You forgot to order honey mustard. Oh, he goes, but oh, that's okay. I got you covered. You're in. And my mom would laugh. Mom knows honey mustard for everything. I don't even know what she said. She dipped her popcorn. I mean, everything. Another one of her favorite desserts was pecan pie. She loved pecan pie and angel food cake. Angel food cake stemmed from, I think, her mother, because every birthday I ever had, we had angel food cake. I just want to call this a celebration of life, because My mom wouldn't want it any other way. She would say, clear those tears. This is happy thoughts and happy times. And there are just some things I want to get up and talk about, and maybe some things you didn't know about my mom. But she was an awesome lady. Like Dan Arnold says, she was a lady. She was one of the greatest secret keepers I ever knew. When you would tell her something, you'd say, don't tell anybody. She was the best. She didn't tell anybody. So if you had anything to say, she was the best person to talk to, because she said nothing to nobody. She was the greatest secret keeper. She was the best mom. She taught me a lot of things. And she will be dearly missed every day. And I split friends there to the friends of to go get an ice cream cone and get Miss Shirley's her ice cream. And the people said, oh, I'm so glad you're here. We were going to miss you. I hope we keep the tradition of Wednesdays. So I guess Wednesdays it will be. I'll go get an ice cream cone, and our mom and Miss Shirley's will go get her ice cream. So she was the best mom ever. And now I'm going to turn it over. There's 11 years difference between the two of us. So I knew mom in a different way than Danelle did. So Danelle will have some really interesting things too about mom. Thanks.
Yeah, 11 years difference. I think I was, oops. I wasn't supposed to happen. But somehow, my dad and my mom and Dick and Deanna went to Las Vegas. And somehow, in 1976, when they came home, about a year later, here I am. Probably much less than my sister's demise, I'm sure. My mother was an extremely hardworking wife, farm wife with two kids, and somehow my dad and her managed to do all the farming when we were young. But yet she still managed to keep up with all of our school functions and still managed to cook and even teach my sister how to make hamburger out of a box. I don't think I'll ever eat that again. Mom was a person of few words, except when I played sports. She was always my sideline cheerleader and was always heard on the videotapes of the games hollering at me saying, come on, girls, or, oh, Danelle, that's not right. Or I would get the, well, I think the referees were wrong on that call. When I was young, my parents built me my own basketball court. Yes, we lived in the country. It was pretty hard to try durable skills on gravel roads. So my dad decided to take up a huge section between the two garages and build me a pad with my name on the free throw line. And I can promise you, he went to McCool Public Schools and measured the lines to exactly where everything was. And the hoop height. What some of you might know is that my mom became quite the baller. Oh yes, when I was young, my mom would actually come out, not my father, because he was usually too busy in the field, but he would have been taller, so he would have been a better guard. But my mom would come out, and we would play several games of Around the World. I know my classmate's here, so she knows what that's about. We played a lot of horse, and we sure did play a lot of pig. There were times that she would beat me, but I always would try to even that score with another game because I didn't like to lose. I think she would even just kind of let me win because I think she got tired playing because I certainly wasn't going to stop until I won. I think she would just give me that self-boost of confidence, so I think that's probably why she let me win. Or she was just tired, I'm not sure which one it was. As my sports career ended in high school, I got old fast. She never lost the passion to follow sports though. She had the true passion of Husker sports, especially football and volleyball being her two favorites. In the early years, they would go to football games, either in Lincoln or travel to the away games. with some friends from Lincoln. And yes,
they left my sister in charge of me. And we're still going to talk about it.
There may have been things that transpired while they were gone, but I was young. We won't go there. That's a left for a different conversation. When farming life took over, traveling to games was not as frequent as they would like to. But rest assured though, my dad had a big CB radio antenna at the house, which reached miles. And I can promise you, if there was not a working radio in the combine and or in the tractor, we were hanging one with a piece of baling wire and hanging it out the window so we could hear the game. No matter if my mom was in the grain truck or if she was in that tractor, but never in the combine because she was too short to reach it, there would always be a comment if she was hauling some grain in and Nebraska made a score. It would come across the CB radio waves. Holy cow, Nebraska just scored. Today to these days, she still watches these Nebraska football games, but absolutely will not watch or listen to it on the TV. She still to this day has a radio from my sister from the 1980s, which still works by the way, and is tuned in to the country station, 98.1 The Frog is usually what it's on, and they would listen to the game on the radio and then they would mute the TV, but they always knew what was going to happen on the radio before it got to the TV. I didn't care for it, but that was her thing. As a football, Husker football took a downward spiral, as we all know, she became very involved in watching the Nebraska volleyball girls and turned this into her big passion. Her biggest thing was getting the schedule and then always calling me or her dear friend Deanna to make sure she knew exactly what channel it was on, what time it was going to be on, and when was the next game so we didn't miss it. Deanna would always say, I tape them all. You can come over and watch it if you miss one. After the games, whether we lost or we won, I would get a call from her and I would hear her to see how the game went. So it always depended on how the game went, on how those conversations may have went. Some good, some not so good. Those conversations will be dearly missed, and I always will wonder who's going to call me if I miss a game, or I forget what time the game is on. Deanna, you're in charge. Her favorite game that was played was for volleyball was in the Memorial Stadium to set the attendance record. And she just thought that was the neatest and coolest thing that women's sports was making great strides. And it would be her beloved Nebraska Cornhusker volleyball team. While loving all the sports, many of you may not know, she was an avid NFL watcher and loved the Chiefs. It was always a countdown to when that next football season was going to begin right after the Super Bowl. As a matter of fact, she would ask me, when does the season start for this year again? I don't know, Mom, I haven't even looked at the schedule yet. She was, Chiefs' favorite fan was Patrick Mahomes. She really liked enjoying watching the Chiefs game, and you could find her in the chair yelling at the chair, from the chair to the TV, so she was doing armchair coaching, calling plays, and mostly genuinely loving the sport. If games got too close, or it might be a nail biter, either in football or volleyball, she would just get up and start doing some sort of busy work, like vacuuming, doing the dishes, and then she'd come back and ask Dad, well, how's it going? And Dad would say, well, you don't want to come over yet, but you haven't come back yet. So she would just keep cleaning. If they did not play up to her standards, Dad would always say to her, well, it's because you're just not hollering at them loud enough, Mom. They can't hear you. And believe me, I believe sometimes she would make that actually work because somehow or another, the Chiefs won the Super Bowl this year.
Sorry, Denver fans.
She loved her dear friends, Deanna and Dick Arbuck. I can remember the four of them with them adventures. Never, and I can promise you, a dull moment with those four. We would take frequent trips to Fort Collins in Denver, Colorado to visit my late Uncle Jerry and Aunt Maxine. They were always looking to find their next great deal, maybe even a little junk, maybe even a little treasure. But we always had to find out what it would be to follow one of my Uncle Jerry's famous shortcuts. I remember spending several days going to flea markets and garage sales that the guys, Dick and my Uncle Jerry, and then would all take a map of Fort Collins, Colorado, and he would get up at 4 o'clock in the morning and get a newspaper, and he would take that map and he would mark exactly every garage sale that was in Fort Collins, Colorado. I am not kidding. I can assure you, there were a lot of great laughs in that van. It got so serious that my dad and Dick decided to build a trailer to pull behind the conversion vans we owned. Deanna and Dick owned one, and my mom and dad owned one, so they would take turns when we would go out there. Well, Dick the engineer, and then my dad's ingenuity, they came up with what we called the dumpster. Why? Because they painted it brown, like Gacho's dumpster, but had two big wheels. It had shock absorbers so that you could open it up and put your stuff in. As we got through all the flea markets and were on our way home, they would look in the back of that dumpster and they would go, Dick would say, well, I think we got room for something else. My dad would say, well, where else is there to stop? So we would always find something on the way home, either in Cheyenne or in Western Nebraska for sure. In 1967, they decided to build, or actually buy, their first trailer house at Harlan County Lake. There were many, many late night fishings, caught hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of fish, and Mom would go night fishing with my dad, and they would get in, clean until the sun come up, rinse, repeat, go to bed, start all over every day. The one thing my mom said, and to this day, she said, the best thing they ever did for fishing is they put a limit on them babies. 15 is plenty. She got tired of cleaning hundreds of fish at a time. As years went on, they moved a few different trailer houses in, and then finally in 2007 came their last trailer house that we currently still have. Once I got older, Mom kind of gave up the fishing thing, but she still liked to be at the lake. And the things that she would do at the lake would be either watching The Price is Right, or she would go to Rep City, to Frida's, to find something to fill the trailer house with, trust me. Or we would go to Alma to the flea markets and walk all the boutiques and find something there. And usually something sweet too, because there was a bakery. Mom, you will be dearly missed, and I will certainly miss your phone calls to ask what time that game is on, or what channel, or just to give you that update, or for that fact, when I'm fishing, you give me your update. I know that you will hear you cheering from loud above, and right perhaps the Chiefs will get their three-peat. Sorry, Denver. I got some family here from Denver. The Broncos boo. Okay, and perhaps, just maybe, we might have a Nebraska football team this year, fingers crossed. And I'm hopeful that our volleyball girls will make it a national championship to make her proud. All I know is that I miss her a lot. Sorry, I feel so long.
Mm-hmm.
generations rise and pass away. We praise you for all of your servants who, having lived this life in faith, now live eternally with you. We especially thank you for your servant, Donna. We praise you for the gift of her life, for all in her that was good and kind and faithful, for the love and the grace you gave her. Dear Lord, as we remember the dedicated life of Donna, we're also aware of the hole left behind as she is now in your presence. Comfort us as we mourn her loss. Wrap your arms around us and hold us tight as we yearn for your presence. Grant us all, your love never ends. When all else fails, you still are God. We pray to you for one another, for all anywhere who mourn with us this day. To those who doubt, give light. To those who are weak, strength. To all who have sinned, mercy. And to all who sorrow, your peace. O God, all that you have given us is yours. Thank you, Lord, for blessing us with this very, very special person, whom we all remember so fondly, but who is now at rest in your loving embrace. Thank you for her life and the many happy memories that we all share. And we pray that you will be a special comfort to uplift and care for those who will feel the greatest loss. For though we are separated for just a time, we will all rejoice one day when we stand together in your presence, reunited in the hope that is set before us. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Tammy, Donna, I didn't know that I didn't have the privilege of knowing your mom, but I feel like I learned a lot today. I loved your stories. Always remember your memories. Support your dad. My friends, grief is hard. There will be times when memories sneak up on you and run down your face. There will be times when things happen that remind you of how much love there was. And there will be countless times when your heart will be comforted by something Donna said or did, by music that reminds you of her. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up the continuance upon you and give you peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. At this time, it's the conclusion of the funeral service here. You are all invited to a dinner at the Legion. And now I'd like to close us in a luncheon blessing. Gracious God, bless the food at our lunch, the hands that have prepared it, and bless us as we partake, that we may be nourished for our work as disciples in your earthly kingdom. Amen.
Build you a home in the midst. the stars, oh how bright they'll shine on a world the Lord must have helped design. The stars, oh how bright they'll shine on that home. Where I'll build